Alô, alô, testando. Oi, oi. Boa noite, pessoal. Boa noite aos que estão online, pessoal que está presente aqui. Gostaria de agradecer primeiramente aí a presença de todos. Desculpe um pouco aí pelo atraso, né? Nesta noite aqui nós vamos falar um pouco aí das práticas dos gigantes da web. Não sou eu quem vou falar fazer essa apresentação, uma apresentação que está prevista para 2 horas. Então, a gente vai falar sobre muita coisa, várias práticas, vários termos. Então, eu só vou apresentar aqui. Nós somos uma empresa de consultoria chamada Octo, e nós acreditamos que tem sempre uma melhor maneira de fazer as coisas, né? Então, no, nos últimos anos, nós temos trabalhado muito nessa parte de inovação dentro das empresas, trabalhando com grandes players aí de internet. E a ideia hoje, né, mostrar um pouco dessa experiência, né? Então, inclusive, né, gostaria de citar também a Octo, ela é uma empresa francesa que trabalha com consultoria na parte de agilidade, arquitetura, e grande parte desse conteúdo está baseado num livro que foi lançado na França, chamado, né, Os Gigantes da Web. Esse livro está em processo de tradução, está sendo traduzido para o inglês. Ele está disponível para download, vai ficar disponível para todos vocês, e onde nós estamos apresentando e detalhando cada uma dessas práticas, né? Então, o consultor, um dos consultores da Octo que vai fazer essa apresentação hoje, ele chama Mathieu Despris. E ele é um consultor da Octo, da França, ajudou na escrita do livro e tem trabalhado aqui. A gente não pode revelar o nome, mas no maior operador aí, de e-commerce aqui do Brasil, ajudando a implementar várias dessas práticas que vão ser apresentadas hoje. Então, o pessoal que está online, participem, façam perguntas, né? A ideia é que a gente possa trazer o máximo de interação e que todo mundo aí possa aprender alguma coisa. Então, mais uma vez, obrigado e tenha aí uma boa sessão.
Olá, boa noite. Desculpa, eu vou fazer esta apresentação em inglês, porque meu português não é suficiente. So, let's go for this presentation about the Web Giants, this book that we wrote. I will introduce with just a look back about what happened since 15 years. It's what I call the Internet tsunami. So we had in around 2000 the first wave of internet at the end of the 90s with few people connected, low bandwidth, something like this. And there is a very marking picture I want to show you is this. Two election of the Pope in 2005 and 2013, 8 years in between. And totally different behavior, totally different way of living this moment. Everybody in 2013 is connected with large bandwidths to do everything in their life, to attend to every event. And this is what you will see maybe this word in on the web, in the literature, in the articles at this moment, is that we call digitalization. Yesterday, internet was just a tool to send mails more faster, to send documents more faster, to just this. Today, numerical technologies are changing everything. The way we communicate, the way we work, we learn, we do business, the way we live. This is digitalization, the reinvention of business models, way of working, the corporate culture, using the benefits of numeric technology. And it's only the beginning. If you just look about what we start to hear about this more and more and more, is the Internet of Things. So soon, it's already on the market. You can track your activity levels when you are doing sports with your iPhone and things like this. There is also home automation. You can heat your home efficiently. So lots of gadgets that are already on the market. Very soon, we will have the connected cars, connected to do some car diagnostics, for example, or even vehicle-to-vehicle communication to avoid collision, like we have in a plane. Why not in a car with the good connected cars? Also, we have the utilities, energy, the smart grids. So on the right, you have the smart meter that exists. I think it's the model that exists in Brazil. On the right, you have the model that exists in France. So more and more, we'll have this objects sending data. I know that the French version, they plan to send data every 250 milliseconds. So all the houses in France and in the world are going to send data about their usage of energy. This is huge. This is huge. We also have crazy things like this. This is a connected cow on the web. The UK farmers are tracking cow's behavior through the internet. Soon we will have the babies. So, okay, everything will be connected. And what we need to understand is that all this data sent by all these connected objects, connected things, all this data will end in the IT systems of some company one day, and they will make money from it. That's for sure. This is this sentence that the big data is the new oil. We'll see this over and over and over for the connected things, and the things will accelerate more and more. And it's, of course, it's not only about the data. There will be new usages, new services, new competitors for companies, new things in the coming years. So sooner or later, every company will face the same problematics that the web giant had to face. Lots of data, very low latency to answer to queries, to APIs, to services, things like this. I just want to give you two examples of companies that totally failed their transformation to the numerical technology. First one is Kodak. I think you already heard about Kodak. They were doing some films for analogic cameras, and they invented numerical cameras, digital cameras. They invented digital cameras, and they failed. They went bankrupt. So they knew at the time that it was a revolution. They invented this revolution, and they failed to transform their company to this revolution. Another one. So this one, you don't know it. It's a French company, La Redoute. It's a very, very, very old company. I think it started in the end of 29th century. Very old company. And in the last 50 years, they had a business of selling clothes at distance. You have catalogs and you can buy clothes and you receive by mail, things like this. And in fact, it was one of the first company in France to go to internet. The first website they have to sell their products on the internet was in 1994. So they anticipated the change of internet, the new way of selling products, the new way of doing this. And one month ago, this company went bankrupt and has been sold for €1 to a competitor. So this company totally understood the changes of internet, and they failed to transform themselves. And this is what I want to pass to you, that we are in the beginning of big changes, I believe, that's what I believe, big changes in our companies, in our the way we work. Let's go back a little bit about this question of how we work in the software. Lots in software engineering, lots of our methods of working inherits from the civil engineering, are Just look at the words: architecture, infrastructure, urbanism, foundations. When you look at specification, it's big design up front. You have specification, big plannings. You have to deliver at fixed dates, all these things. So it's, we inherit our world methods of working inherits from this. For a long time, it was okay because before 2000, especially, the objective of software engineering was to put in computer, literally in silicon, it was to put into CPUs, into silicon, processes that were well mastered, like accounting, supply chain, invoicing, payroll. Okay, it was processes that we well mastered. Okay, we just industrialized them into computers. And we, okay, we just do specification, we put that on machines, and we work with it. But as you know, I don't know if some of you are doing agile. I hope that most of you are tend to do agile today. You know that these old ways of working are not working anymore. Today, what we need is more something more organic, more connectivity with many people, with many partners, with many other companies around you. We need to adapt. We need to connect fast, discover new usages, experiment new ones, experiment new ways of working. And I think this image is much more the way we need to work in the future. And I think that some companies, the web giants, they manage to do this. They manage to do this. That is what I want to share today. So you know all these names: Amazon, Google, Twitter, Facebook. The thing is, they are not the biggest companies in the world. Just take Google. Google, in 2012, it's $50 billion of revenues. If you take the biggest company in Brazil, Petrobras, they had three times this revenue in 2012. So they are very big companies, they have very, very big revenues, but not so big. But they totally changed their market. Google changed everything in the way we use our computers. Amazon changes everything in the e-commerce. Twitter, Facebook, I think you understand the idea. Wikipedia, they killed the encyclopedia business. So here is only US companies. I will talk a little bit in the future later about French companies. If you have examples of Brazil companies that have some very interesting practices, I will love to hear about that, and just please give me examples during the presentation or after. I will be very happy to discuss if there were such practices are in place in Brazil. Okay, just little disclaimer: I never worked for Google, Facebook, Twitter. Nobody at Octo in my company ever worked for them. And in fact, unfortunately, they don't even use consulting. They don't care about consulting, so we have no chance to work there. But what is interesting is that they communicate a lot. Blogs, conferences, GitHub, everywhere they communicate, they communicate, they communicate. And we can find a lot information on how they work, what is their philosophy, what is their culture. So sometimes it's communication, so sometimes it's a little bit embellished, but whatever, what is interesting is the culture and the philosophy behind, and it's very interesting. Okay, so as we said at the beginning, if you have questions, remarks, you can just raise your hand and ask question. On the web, you can just do a sign, and my colleague will take the question. So this presentation is a bit long, but I think we can take a few questions without any problem. Okay, let's go. So the agenda of this presentation is about is these three things. Okay, so much original, bigger, faster, better. And I will talk about their practices in these different domains. Let's go for the bigger. First subject, commodity hardware. Just think a little bit about Google. When they were created, their business model was to build, to index all the web. 50 billions of web pages, and they put on themselves a very high constraint of short response time when you do a query. They started like this. So anyway, with any solution existing on the market, any type of hardware, anything, they had the problematic of distributing the data on many machines. And second aspect, that what we need to understand is that the revenue they have are not proportional to the volume of data they have. It's not very common in the traditional business. They have a lot of data, and the revenue are not at all proportional to that. So they need to be very, very, very cost efficient on the storage and the manipulation of this data. So they had a choice. Either they use high-end architecture, very big machines like a mainframe or any kind of machine of this type, or HP Superdome, or I don't know, a very big machine of this kind, with highly redundant hardware, symmetric multiprocessing, lots of CPU, RAM, disk, etc., and they try to distribute the data and the processing on several machines like this. Or they use what we call today commodity hardware, low-end machine like x86 machines, very traditional, what we call pizza box with a few CPUs and disk inside, and no hardware redundancy at all. This is a key concept, the hardware redundancy. And the big one, everything is redundant. The power supply, the disks are redundant, the memory, everything is redundant. Here is commodity hardware. If the least element fails, the machine is down. Okay, this is a very different approach. And they studied the question. And they produce this white paper, The Data Center as a Computer. I warmly recommend you to read this. It's huge. It's 150 pages or even more of very, very interesting information about the design of a data center at this scale. What are the costs? And in fact, they measured everything to understand what would be the most cost efficient. They measured the power efficiency of all the hardware parts. They measured the performance to power ratio, and also the cost per transaction executed. They studied the costs. They produce some cost models of the failure. Okay, I have a disk that is failing in a commodity hardware, so maybe all the machine will go down. What is the impact on the cost of the whole data center with some probability statistics? And they came with a conclusion is commodity hardware is 3 to 12 times cheaper for them. I insist on the for them because they have some cost structure. Maybe your IT company doesn't have the same cost structure in the data center, but for them it was clear that commodity hardware was the cheaper option. And so they started to design data centers only based on commodity hardware. They started to design applications distributed on thousands of non-reliable machines. And these two things just change everything. We'll talk about what I'm going to talk after that is coming from these things. They change all the software design just because of this constraint. If you don't know, today Google is 1 million machines. 1 million machines. Incredible. Yes. So, with these studies, they say, okay, we are going to use small machines. Small is beautiful, but you have few constraints. If you have to deploy on many machines, that changes everything. You need to automate things a lot. Okay, you are not going to do manual deploy on 1 million machines. And in turn, the consequence of this is that the web giant became the champions of infrastructure automation. We will talk about this later on. And that's why they became the champions of the cloud, the cloud business. As well, they needed to completely redefine application resilience, application tolerance to failure. Since the hardware is not reliable and constantly fails, you need to have systems that are on top of this at the software level that will manage the failures of the hardware. This is the key. Resilience must be handled by software, especially for database. And this changes everything in the architecture after that. Let's start with one. Sharding and all the NoSQL stuff. So NoSQL, not only SQL. Maybe some of you already use this kind of solution. Yes? More or less? Okay. The idea of NoSQL is to go beyond the relational database management system limitation. Of course, when you need to index 50 billions of web page on non-reliable machine, you are not doing it with Oracle. Sorry for Oracle people that could listen to me, but you are not going to do it with Oracle. So they need to find another way. And all the web giants face more or less the same situation, and they had to invent their own storage to go beyond this limitation. Okay, Google is Bigtable. Bigtable with column family model, a key value, the value being a key value as well. Amazon, a key value store with some intelligent replication in a ring. Facebook, they created Cassandra, they pushed it on the open source community, and then they also developed some solution around MySQL, especially a key value usage of MySQL in a sharded manner. LinkedIn, they developed Voldemort, a key value store as well, etc., etc., etc. All the web giants had to find new solutions, new way to store and manage data at this scale. And this is what we see today in the software landscape is all about this. The need for speed and availability. Just think about that. Amazon, 100 milliseconds of degradation of latency, response time of the systems behind the web pages is 1% of revenue loss. Google, more than half a second in the page load is 20% of page views loss, etc., etc. They need to go fast. They need to respond to answer fast to the user at the other end. And this is the key element. Look as well to the unavailability. At Amazon, 1 minute of unavailability costs $50,000 of revenues. So they need to design solutions that are very available and very fast. Just to let you know, the blink of an eye is longer than the constraint that Amazon has. It's incredible. Let's talk a little bit about the CAP theorem. Who here knows about the CAP theorem already? Okay, let's go. When you when you think about data storage, there are some characteristics that you may want to have in this system, and there are three key characteristics: A for availability, C for consistency, P for partition tolerance. Availability, I think that everyone understands, it's the system is said to be available when the user can access the system, reading or writing. They can access the system without a problem, so the system is said to be available. Consistency is to say that all users have the same version of information. I don't have two different versions of information that are visible by the different users. Or, if I say it in another way, let's imagine I'm using my Amazon account with my computer and with my mobile. If I change, I don't know, some personal information in my account on my computer, I want to see the same information. I want to make sure, I want to be sure that the same information is visible on the mobile. This is consistency. Partition tolerance is the most complex to understand. Partition tolerance, the system continues to work in case of network partition, that is to say when different nodes cannot communicate. If you have one single machine, one single database, you don't have to worry about partition tolerance because you have only one node. You don't have network partition between one node. So, okay, let's forget about P. If you have several nodes, the different nodes need to communicate to share the data, to replicate the data, to send the updates, get the reads, get all the information. And this system, if it is distributed on many nodes, is sensible to this problem of partition tolerance. What says the CAP theorem? CAP theorem is, at first it was a conjecture by a guy called Eric Brewer. But now it has been proved as a real theorem. There is a proof of this that says that you can only pick two of these three characteristics at the same time. Let's go back to my example with one node. If I have only one node, I don't need to bother about P. I can be consistent and available at the same time. I talk to an Oracle database, the data is consistent with the transaction, and the system is available to answer my query until a failure of the node, of course, but when the node is alive, I can get the data. If you have a distributed system, you have to pick only two of the of this characteristic. On large websites, I said that unavailability of Amazon 1 minute costs a lot of money, so they cannot forget. A, they cannot lose the availability. They need to be available all the time. So, since the system is distributed and we need to be partition tolerant, they need to forget about the consistency. This is by theorem. You cannot do something else. And this is what all the web giants design in their data store system, in their NoSQL data store, is this characteristic of eventual consistency data stores, systems that are not consistent all the time. Let me give you an example. If I go on Facebook and I post some information on the wall of a friend, maybe two of you will not see this new information on the wall at the same time. This is a loss of consistency. So for Facebook, we can understand. For Amazon is e-commerce. Amazon is, okay, I'm buying products. What is non-consistent system when I need to buy products and have transactions? In fact, they managed to do this. They redesigned all the application to support the fact that the system, the data store, is eventually consistent. It will be consistent at some point, but right now, I don't have the certitude that the system is consistent. For example, if you go to Amazon and put some product in your shopping cart and buy it, this shopping cart is replicated 4 times on the different nodes of DynamoDB, and all you don't have the guarantee that all these 4 nodes have the same version of information. And the Amazon application is designed to support this. And even more, let's say that you buy, and unfortunately, someone else buy the same product, and no more products is available in the store. Okay, Amazon will just give you back your money and say, okay, we give you 10% more, 10% of reduction for your next purchase. So they adapted all the application and all their business processes to the fact that sometimes the shopping cart is not consistent and is wrong. And this is a complete transformation of the way we think transaction. This is a little bit more advanced. I will try to tell it. I say available, consistent. So available, we think about up and running, or not available, crashed. In fact, it's a little bit more complex than that. It's also about latency and response time. If you have several nodes that need to synchronize their own version of data to be consistent, it will take time, so the overall system will not respond fast. So you will have a great latency. Latency is very close to unavailability, because if you have long latency, you have timeout and then system unavailable. So this is this idea of, at the moment you have a distributed system with the P characteristic, you have a balance between consistency and availability. But this is very advanced. If you want, we can talk hours about this, but this is a very interesting question. So, let me summarize. NoSQL, created by all the web giants, a radically different approach to database, distributed storage, tolerating failure by replicating data. Remember that it's commodity hardware, the hardware may fail, and the system is tolerating this. Consistency constraint is relaxed, so we have eventual consistency after a period of time. Focus is put on availability and low response time, low latency, and all the NoSQL systems tend to be linearly horizontally scalable. I just need to add machines, and the system scales, not to infinite, of course, but to the very large numbers that we see at the web giant, the 50 billions of web pages, the 1 billion of users at Facebook, all this kind of thing. So we have variety of data models, key value store, column-oriented store, graph database as well. LinkedIn is using a graph system to explore the relationship between people. They develop things around this. This is very interesting. I will pass on this one. Still in this question of data storage and data management, but not on the transaction, not on the read and write all the time. There is all this question of big data that we hear all constantly. These days, you open a journal, you open a technical magazine, we talk about big data. Big data, the thing of storing that amount of data and analyzing it to find information about your business. The thing that when you hear about big data today, in fact, behind this, at 99% of chance that it is Hadoop behind this, and Hadoop is coming from the work of Google. I will explain this. Just to understand what they why they needed to create this new way of storing massive amount of data for analysis. There is the, you know, you all know the Moore's law that says that the performance of machines, of CPU, of memory, of disk space, everything is growing exponentially relative to cost. For $1, I have a certain amount of power in the CPU today. In 18 months, I will have twice this power, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So you all know this kind of curves of exponential increase of performance or decrease of price for the same performance. But there is one thing that is not following the Moore's law. Here you have certain amount of money. This is the growth of disk space. A common disk. You take a disk in the market for a personal computer or enterprise computer. This is the typical growth of storage capacity that you had in 30 years for an amount of price. If you look at the bandwidth of these disks, in more or less the same amount of time, so on the left we had a growth of 100,000 of the storage capacity per the price. If you look at the bandwidth, that is the throughput to put data in or to read data back from your disk, in more or less the same duration, we had only less than 100 increase of the performance. What does this mean? This means that for the same amount of money, we can store 100,000 times more data. But it takes 1,000 times more to read it. Okay, so we can store, but we cannot read it back very fast. This is a key problem that we have today with this the technology we have with the bandwidth and with kind of thing. And this constraint gives a new opportunity to Google to analyze this problem and find a genius idea. It's the Google paper, Map Radius. So, the data at Google is stored on many machines. It's distributed. They created a file system distributed like this. The name is GFS, Google File System. And all the web pages, the index, and everything is stored like this. All the data is splitted into parts. They call these chunks. And these chunks are distributed on many, 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 many machines. And they find a way to speed up, to turn around this problem of bandwidth, this problem of the time to access the data. And this is MapReduce. The key principle of MapReduce, if you read the paper, they start the paper and they say we want three characteristics. We want to parallelize, distribute, and load balance the processing on the many nodes that we have. So the chunk are distributed on the machine. We want to distribute the processing on this. We need to be fault tolerant. That means that we need to hide failure of node during the processing. I run a processing on and thousands of machines. If one node fails, I don't care. I don't want to care about that. I want to be the system. I want the system to be resilient. And this idea of co-locating the processing and data, okay. So it takes time to take the data out of the machines because of the bandwidth problem. Okay, I send the processing the closer as I can to the disk, so I don't need to move the data a lot. And this is my produce. So we have the splits here, or the chunks of data that are distributed on many nodes. And we have a map phase and a reduce phase here to process all this data. In fact, they just reinvented the stored procedure. Stored procedure is just code that is run on the database. They just reinvented this, but instead of using a horrible language, they use Java. And instead to have something that runs only on one database, the system can run on thousands of machines. And this, the MapReduce Google paper, the strategy of storage of on many chunks in the Google file system gave birth to Hadoop. Hadoop is this. Hadoop is a distributed storage. At Google, it's called GFS, Google File System. In Hadoop, it's called HDFS, Hadoop Distributed File System. It's distributed processing, MapReduce. Today, we have more options of distributing the processing, but the core idea is the MapReduce on distributed processing, and tools on top of this that are relying on the MapReduce to distribute processing on many machines. That's why today Google and all the users of Hadoop are able to distribute some querying, some processing of very big data for a very, very low cost. And so they just invented a new way of doing BI, because traditionally we do BI, we choose some subset of data, we put that in an operational data store, we move that to the BI data warehouse, blah, 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 we use schema, it's very complex. They just reinvented totally the way of doing business intelligence and data analytics. So one of the key ideas is that they consider that all the data is valuable, and they store everything, structured data, of course, but also unstructured data to analyze it. Their systems can scale to petabytes of storage. If you just Yahoo, they have a Hadoop cluster of 42,000 machines. Zero license cost, only hardware cost, and of course human work to manage. That's it. It's incredible. Also the fact that they don't force the data to match a predefined data model with tables and schema. Instead, they use this approach of schema and read. Okay, I want to read this data. This data happens to be a log file, Apache log file, for example, let's say Apache log file. Okay, I will interpret on the fly that this data is an Apache log, This is very flexible, and they stop moving the data. So in the past, we use ETL to extract, transform, load, and move the data from database to operational data store to the processing, and they just stop to do this because it's not performant. Instead, they move the processing to the data and distributed it. This is, I find this change amazing. Just because they need the scale and commodity hardware, they create all of this. This makes me move to the next point. Build versus buy. Traditionally, in IT departments, we like to buy software. We don't like to build. We are not going to build our own data, our own database. We are just using Oracle or MySQL or things like this. We just buy, or when it's open source, we just use something from the market. Sometimes it's not fitting very well because we have problems or because the solution is very generic and we have very specific needs, so we need to live with that. The web giant, they build everything. And that makes sense, of course, because if you have thousands and thousands of machines and you need to pay license, it would not make sense to buy, of course. But it goes beyond this idea of cost. This is the only consultant slide I have in my deck, typical consulting slide. You need to concentrate and build the software that is unique, differentiating, and perceived that as a competitive advantage. A database engine is a competitive advantage for Amazon. It is a competitive advantage for Facebook. Facebook is not going to have the same database engine than LinkedIn because mastering their own database engine is a competitive advantage. So it's strategic, and they need to go fast on this so they build their own solution. On the other end, when it's common to all companies, you can see it as a resource. For example, payroll, accounting. Okay, you don't need to build this. You just outsource that. So BPO is business process outsourcing. You can use this as a service. For example, Salesforce. If it's not your business to build software for CRM or contact management, you just buy Salesforce. This is this idea. And that's why they build every bit of software. It's because it gives them a competitive advantage on the competition. Another difference also that we see with the traditional IT department in our companies is that they use and they contribute massively to open source. Traditionally, in our IT department, we are very closed source, proprietary, intellectual property. We don't share our best ideas. They do the exact opposite. Google is publishing paper. Facebook, they develop tools around MySQL and the sharding of MySQL. They created Cassandra. They created Swift, which is a very powerful communication protocol between services internally to your platform. They even created the Open Compute initiative. Open Compute is open source hardware and data center design. Just stop inventing your own data center. You go to Open Compute and you have lists and lists and lists of documentation about the best way to build a data center Facebook-like. It's incredible. They just share this information. Amazing. Google, of course, they share a lot. They contribute a lot to open source. Android, GWT, even if GWT is on the decline today, but they build Gmail with this. Chromium, at the core of Chrome, the Linux kernel, they need so much mastery about the Linux that runs in their data center that they patch the Linux kernel and they share this. The paper, as I told, LinkedIn, Voldemort was open source, so it's a database. Kafka is a middleware. It's very, very performant message middleware. Zoe is an index dedicated to LinkedIn, an index search index. Netflix, they have a list of software that is incredible. I will show you just one example. So this is this philosophy that they only trust software, they act by themselves. They don't buy software, they take software, they patch it, they change it, they contribute to open source. they take the ownership of some open source project and they lead the project to have this competitive advantage and to master the software. Same idea of openness, open API. An open API is a way to expose services of application to be reused by others to build and enrich their own services and applications. The web giants are using open APIs a lot. I will show you this. For example, this site, Programmable Web, it's a directory with all the APIs that are public and open that you can use to build mashups, like for example Google Maps. So you can use the Google Maps API to build a mashup with your own application and build a better service for your customer. And all the web giants are there sharing APIs, opening their IT system to collaborate, to have an ecosystem around them. These figures are huge. It's still programmable web that does this measurement, this study. Twitter is 13 billion API calls a day. Twitter is quite a small company. Not far from now, there were only, I think, 400 people. Now I think there are more because they acquired companies, but 400 people and they have 13 billion API calls a day. Incredible. Google, Facebook, they all have this openness of their system to the rest. If we just look at Twitter, Twitterverse is all the companies and services built on top of Twitter API. Crazy. How much partner do you have at your company using your API? This is crazy. For branding, geographics, interest graph, dashboard, event management, live streaming, geolocation, relationship, marketing and advertising, rich media, communication management, research analysis, stream management, mobile application. And I cut the image because it's too big. And there is this idea that at the beginning, Twitter, they did not invest much on graphical user interface. Since the beginning, the graphical user interface of Twitter is not that incredible. But as they provide great APIs, they let others build services, their own interfaces, their own products on top of them. And it happened that one of the companies that built the service was TweetDeck, and TweetDeck did a very good job. TweetDeck, they created a very nice interface on top of Twitter API. And what happened? TweetDeck is now part of Twitter. So Twitter just bought TweetDeck. They just bought the best innovation that they had in their ecosystem. So they take advantage of innovation made by others, individual or companies. It's just crowdsource R&D. So they do R&D for their own APIs, their own backend, their own stuff, and they let the R&D of others creating new things, new services, and they just buy it. It's a very, very nice, very clever idea. Just another example, Sparrow. I don't know if you know Sparrow. It's a Gmail reader. The same. It's an application that is built on top of Gmail APIs. It happens that the CTO of Sparrow did the same engineering school than me, so I'm a little bit jealous. And they created a very nice product, mobile reader for Gmail. What happened? Google bought Sparrow. Crowdsource R&D. This is Brilliant. The same way, API also extend your business. Just this example, Expedia. So 2 billion of revenue per year. 90% of what they do is through APIs. So the same, having an ecosystem, lots of partners that can connect like this. They just need to go to programmable web or another directory. They get the documentation, they connect very fast, they use the API, they are billed for this. They have to pay for it, of course. You can establish some revenue model on top of APIs, of API consumption, and you can grow your business like this. And this is a key idea of the web giant, is this openness, the open API. I want to show you this. This is a memo from Jeff Bezos. Jeff Bezos is the CEO of Amazon. It's in 2002. And what he says is this: all teams will expose their data and functionality through service interfaces. All service interfaces, without exception, must be designed from the ground up to be externalizable. That is to say, the team must plan and design to be able to expose the interface to developers in the outside world. No exception. So they are not building a service for themselves, for their own internal application. They are building service for others, for the ecosystem first. And anyone who doesn't do this will be fired. This is how Amazon became, is one of the reasons why Amazon became the giant that it is today. That's why they are so ahead of competition with the cloud. If you look at the Gartner quadrant of the leaders of innovation and blah 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 about cloud, you have everybody in the middle, and Amazon is there. Just because of this, it's their culture: openness, openness, openness. So open API, lots of advantage to do it. Leverage effect, so you enrich your service portfolio and business opportunities with many partners. You do bigger things by using collective intelligence of the web, crowdsource R&D. You create an ecosystem around you. Just an example, Opodo, they have an escape map service, is built on Google Maps API. And Opodo discovered that they have twice more revenues with the service, with Google Maps, than without. Just by integrating open service that is ready, they have twice more revenue. Genius. Indirect effect. To be open like this, that improves the quality. Because if you want your API to be used, you need to be very clean. You need to have the best API. The companies of the world are looking at what you are doing, and it brings pressure on you to improve your API and your code. So this improves your quality. And also, it attracts talented people. The best way to attract good developers, it's the best way to attract good developers, because they will want to come and work with those who created these APIs. I'm sure that a lot of you will just dream of working with Twitter, with the developer of Twitter, of course. Okay, let's stop there for the bigger part. Let's move to the next chapter, faster. Again, if you have questions, raise your hand. Raise your hand on the internet. Thiago will take care of this. Faster. Facebook. One of the things we most value at Facebook Engineering is moving fast. So remember, in the introduction, I said that in the past, we industrialized existing business process like accounting. Today, we are building new products, new services, new things, new stuff. This is innovation. And when you say innovation, you will fail. You will make bad assumptions about your customers. You will be wrong about who are your customers. You will imagine features that no one wants or that no one will pay for it. You will have bugs and crashes. You will design architectures with design flaws, with big problems. You will fail, you will fail, you will fail, because this is innovation. And the web giant integrated this in their culture. Eric Schmidt, former Google CEO, we try things and we celebrate failures. This is a company where it is absolutely okay to try something that is very hard, have it not be successful, take the learning and apply it to something new. Just a parenthesis, Google, the number of products that Google built and throw to the bin and throw to the graveyard. Google Reader is dead. iGoogle, Google Health, Null, Google Buzz, SideWiki, Google Notebook, Google Dictionary, Google Wave, SearchWiki, and blah, 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 and blah, blah, blah. They try to build products. They try to find if the product meets its market. Sometimes it's a complete failure. Sometimes it works, like Google Reader was very fine for long years, but they were not earning enough money, I guess, from it, so they decided to discontinue. Null was a complete failure. Google Wave, I think that Google Wave was just 5 years ahead of its time. Thing like this. They try, they fail, they do something else. But they learn about this. This is very important. Mark Zuckerberg, Facebook, move fast and break things. You have to break things. You have to think out of the box, break things, and okay, it doesn't work. Okay, let's roll back, let's do something else. Marissa Mayer, Yahoo, failure is totally okay as long as you fail fast. Fail fast, to succeed faster. Fail fast because the earlier you get the information that is a failure, the more money you save, of course, and the earlier you learn about the market, about the customer, to build something else. Maybe there's a similar concept to this fail fast. And I think it's already written there, Lean Startup Machine. Lean Startup is a philosophy, so it's not for web giants, or at least not at the beginning, it's for startups, but it's very close in the culture of this, with the idea of minimum viable product. So Eric Ries, a pioneer of the Lean Startup movement, Lean Startup philosophy, gave this definition. The minimum viable product is that version of a new product which allows a team to collect the maximum amount of validated learning about customers with the least effort. Validated learning. It is almost scientific. You take assumptions, you measure, and you take decision from this, from your experimentation. And you try to do it with the least effort as possible. Why? The idea is to fail fast, is to fail cheap. The idea is not to work on a product for 2 years and discover that this product doesn't match the market. You want to learn things in 1 week, if you can, and change the way you see your product and adapt. This is this idea of failing cheap, because if you lose a few money, you can afford to take this risk. You are not putting your company in danger, so you can take small risk. If you lose 2 weeks of development, that's very fine. You can test things and innovate. And I want to take this example. It's one of the most incredible example of minimum viable product. I think that if you look at minimum viable product examples on the web, you will find this one at the first on the list is Dropbox. Dropbox, they wanted to raise funds, so they had this idea, okay, I will create an incredible file sharing system on your computer that works. So computer, mobile, at work, at home, everywhere, it will be marvelous, and it will be, the storage will be in the cloud on S3, Amazon S3, Amazon Web Services storage. And they wanted to raise funds, so they created the startup, and they wanted to raise funds on this idea. So they went to meet the venture capitalists, the investors, and say, okay, I have a fantastic idea of file sharing, I want money. And the investors said, no, we don't believe you. File sharing product, there are tons on the market. Who will want yours? I won't put any money on this. No client will be interested. And so they build a minimum viable product. The minimum viable product of Dropbox is this, a landing page, a single HTML page with zero line of code. Just a form where you can put your email if you are interested in the concept. And second element of the minimum viable product is a video. A video, maybe you don't see it very well on this screenshot. It's paper that is cut. It's nice, but it's paper. And they do a cartoon with paper to say, oh, our new service of sharing files is very nice. You can do it this way, with bonhomes that move like this, and a cartoon. This is the minimum viable product. They put that on the web. In one weekend, they had, I think, 50,000 mails of early adopters ready to use it right now. I just want it right now. And so they went to the investors and say, okay, in one weekend, we have a customer base of 50,000 people ready to use it. Zero line of code. This is a minimum viable product. This is this idea of short cycle to validate quickly each hypothesis. You have ideas, you build fast a product, and you measure fast data to learn on it for the product and for customer. Okay. My hypothesis is that my customer will be this kind of guy. Maybe I'm wrong. I need to validate this hypothesis. This guy will need a product like this. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe he wants another type of product. And I need to validate this. Just to give you an example. This is not a web giant at all, unfortunately. It's a service that two colleagues at Okto wanted to create, and we kind of incubate their idea for a while, and they followed this idea of Lean Startup. So, minimum viable product, this is a landing page. There are almost no code behind this. It's a landing page with a side of this, an email campaign marketing, an email describing the product and say, okay, if you are interested in this product, please come on this page. And it's just to very fast, I will not go very deep in this. It's online recruitment service. It's like dating service, but to meet your boss, choose your boss. And instead of putting your resume on the web and getting lots of emails and calls and blah, 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 you go there and you choose the boss that interested you. So it's kind of dating service, choose your boss. It's a nice idea. Take back the power. Okay, and they had this idea of course, if I want to create a new service, when I can put my resume, I don't want to fill in my resume again. I already did it in LinkedIn, or maybe Viadeo. I don't know if you know Viadeo. It's a competitor of LinkedIn. It's a French company that is quite growing. So I already did it with LinkedIn or Viadeo. I don't want to file my resume again on a new site. So they created a sign-in. As we can see in many service, web service today, it's sign-in using a network like this. So sign-in with LinkedIn, Viadeo, and they put a third alternative. I don't have any of this network. And they didn't know at all how much people would use LinkedIn, how much prospect would use Viadeo, and how much prospect would refuse to sign in with one of these two networks and do something else. And they send their email, they put this online, and they take measures, and they measure that 6% of people refused to use the social network. 6%. Okay, so I don't even need to develop this feature to create an account without an open authentication system, with an open system with LinkedIn, connectivity with LinkedIn. So I don't even need to do this. So they saved, so they tested their hypothesis, they tested the market, and they discovered that this feature is not necessary, that they are not going to spend money on a feature that nobody or 6% of people will use. This is this idea of testing very fast some hypothesis or testing your customer very fast with 1 week. It's 1 week of development, this, only this, and they answered one question. Very, very interesting. Very close to this idea of lean startup, minimum viable product, the A/B testing. A/B testing. I won't tell right now about a web giant. I will speak about Obama, kind of web giant as well, because analysts consider that the mastery of internet, of the internet tool, of the networks, of the social network, of the communication internet, had a big fight in both two Obama investitures, both two Obama elections. So they managed the things very well. And one of the things they did is A/B test. The two landing pages of the website for the campaign, they had this version and this one. Okay, so not much change. Okay, so a media. The first one is in color, the second one is black and white. Here the wording is sign up. The second one is learn more, so not much of change. And they did A/B testing on several segments of population. And what they discover is that this version won. It was the best. The best conversion rate was with this version. From 8% of conversion rate with the first one, and 11% of conversion rate with this one. So it's not so much. But when you jump from 8% to 11%, it's a 40% gap. It's not negligible in the term of customer base in the customer elector base in the end. And they consider that within all the conversion funnel, so the landing page and all the things behind this, up to the I give money to Obama to win the election, the difference was $60 million of difference between the two options. So it's not, it's far from negligible. There is a funny thing in this story. In fact, there existed a third version. So the first version, the media in the middle, was not a picture, it was a video. And the marketing team said, imagine a video, and they say, the video will win. The video will be the most powerful, the most attractive landing page. And they completely failed. They were completely wrong. Nobody liked the video. So there is a learning here, is that marketing experts, they know their customer, they know the customer base, they know many things, but sometimes they are plain wrong, and we need to bring data to say, okay, your customer base for this product or this service is not behaving as you may imagine, and we need data to build this idea. Today it's very easy to build A/B testing, or when you have more than two options, A, B, C, D, etc. We say multivariate testing is very easy. Google Analytics or many other tools like A/B testing, for example, you can test several versions of a page, of a service, of a process to see what is working the best. Just in parentheses, so it's very easy on the tool side, it's not so easy on the statistics side, because you have to introduce differences and you have to select the population without a bias on this option. So you need a statistician to avoid bias and have a good measure of what you're doing, but today it's very easy to do analytics and to do A/B testing like this. The thing is, if you go today to Facebook, to your Facebook account, Google, LinkedIn, you are probably a member of a population being A/B tested to measure something about an evolution or something you prefer or thing like this. It's very highly probable that it's this occurs each time you go on this kind of site. We have a very big conference in France called UZI, and we invited last year or 2 years ago, I don't remember, a LinkedIn engineer, and he explained us that LinkedIn is so advanced in the A/B testing system that they are able to test some specific option on a targeted population like the lawyers at Boston. They are able to capture only the lawyers at Boston and offer them a small difference in the service, in the page, in something, just to test if it's more power, it's more relevant for them, for their context. They are very, very strong in this. Maybe you may tell me, yeah. How this, okay, the question is how they separate how they segment the population. I think they have many, many, many options. So if you arrive on your LinkedIn account and you're auto-logged in, so you have, they have a lot of information of you, so they can put you in some segment. If they don't have this, I guess they will use the IP address, as you may mention, or Google. Today, It's not people that considering. It's Google said that there is no general Google. Each of you will have a different Google Google response, Google answers each time you go to Google, because if you are logged in, they have information about the past queries that you did. If you are not logged in, you are from a region, you are from Brazil, not from France or China. They will not flood you with information in Chinese because probably you don't read it. They have lots of things like this. So in this case, it's not A/B testing, but they are able to adapt their software, the web page, the response to your context. And they cross many information like this, cookies, geography, past information, things like this. So I talked about MVP, landing page a lot, Obama, things like this, but you would say, okay, landing page, it's easy to do a new landing page each week to test new options, but when I have a very big software with many years of work of this, how I can change, how I can do change like every week test a new option. In fact, the web giants are also very strong at this. They do what we call continuous deployment. And to start to talk about continuous deployment, I want to quote Mary Popendick from her book, From Concept to Cache. And she asked this very precise question: how long would it take your organization to deploy a change that involves just one single line of code? You have a bug, something to change in an algorithm, in a business rule, something like this. One line of code, how much time will it take to push that into production? And the next question is, how often you are able to do this? And of course, respecting the standard procedure of your company. It's not, you are not calling Superman each day to push things into production. So Superman need to sleep at some time. So we, while respecting your standard processing, how much time does it take? How often are you able to do it? Here is how the web giant do. Facebook, 2 deployments per day. Amazon, a deployment somewhere in data centers in the world every 11 seconds. Right now, at any moment, right now, an average of 10,000 servers are being updated. Flickr, 10 deployments a day. This is continuous deployment. They push code all the time to production, again and again and again and again. It's a kind of, okay, with when you have this kind of numbers, okay, deployment is just a non-event. It's not that painful that we have in our company. It's just normal life. It's deployment all the time. And to do this, you need to industrialize your process, and it's even robotize your process. It's like in a plant when you build cars, it's the same, so you push code into production in the same way, very automated, automated, automated. But you would say, why? Why doing 10 deployments a day for a service like Flickr? Why? Because the first one is still this idea of the wheel rolling and rolling and rolling again. I have ideas, I code fast, and I push the code very fast to production. To measure fast how it behaves on production, I get data and learn fast how it works with my customer, with the performance, and I continue all the time. They do it all the time. So this way, they improve the time to market, and they learn faster. Of course, it needs a lot of metrics to learn faster and the ability to analyze all these metrics, but they are able to do it. Second thing, this is from a real study. I think it's from Flickr. I don't remember. I think it's from Flickr. It's a journal spo that did this, I think. They measure, so they started this process of pushing code into production all the time. And they start to measure the size of the change set that you are going to push in production. What is the amount of change in the code base or in the what you're putting in production? And when they have incidents, the time to recover, the time to go back to a normal service. So either a rollback of the deployment or a change of configuration or I don't know, something, the time to recover. And they found this correlation that it's quite of intuitive. The higher the change set, the higher the time to recover. You have to take more risk by changing a lot of things that if you change very few things, if you change very few things, there is a very little risk of breaking something. And if you do, it's very easy to roll back, or it's very easy to adapt around this. Even if you need to do code to correct the bug, so if you have a very small change set, doing new code of the same size to correct is very fast, and you can push that to production very fast, etc., etc., etc. And instead of focusing on the capability of doing rollbacks of their change of their deployment in production, they focus on their capability to do a new deployment of production that fixes the bug. They prefer to do this. They prefer the time to recover instead of penalty on the time to market. This is the key idea. That's why Flickr is pushing code 10 times a day to production. To do this, you need what we call, there is this movement, the DevOps movement. We studied a little bit DevOps, and what we think is that DevOps is these three components. The idea of infrastructure as code, I will explain. Continuous delivery, so deployment all the time. And of course, collaboration. What is infrastructure as code? Is industrialize and automate everything in your infrastructure. For example, Vagrant to instantiate a virtual machine like this. Chef, Puppet to distribute your code on this machine like this. Git, the ops guy now are using Git. Capistrano to run scripts on thousands of machines. OpenStack for virtualization. Test-driven infrastructure. We are still fighting with the TDD, the test-driven development. They are doing test-driven infrastructure. Okay, my test is I want to have a Node.js of this version being in production. The test is red because I have nothing in production. I prepare the script of Puppet, Chef, blah, 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 blah. I put that in Git. I automate the deployment. Up, the test is green because the Node.js is present at the end. They do test-driven infrastructure. This is this idea of infrastructure as code. Consider everything, the management of the configuration management of the infrastructure as code that you can put in Git. You can branch, you can merge, you can version, you can do whatever you want to be very productive about the management of your infrastructure. This is this idea. For example, Facebook, no one, no administrator ever connect directly to production machine. Never, ever, ever. It's only robots. Only scripts like that are able to instantiate machine, deploy the code, put the machine to attach the machine to a cluster, or remove this machine from the cluster, remove everything, analyze collect the log to analyze. Never ever an admin will connect root or non-root to the machine to do anything. It's only robotized. Of course, if you need to deploy 10 times a day or even once a day, Facebook two times a day, it's so few. you need to have a pipeline to bring code from the dev to production. And this needs to be a very automated pipeline. This diagram, I will not go through in detail. It's an example, a template of what could be a pipeline of build. This is in a book written by Jez Humble. The name of the book is Continuous Delivery, I think. I think it's this. And this idea, and the idea is, okay, I automate the compilation, the unit test, the functional test, how I assemble packages, how I run the functional test on them, how I can push to quality assurance platform if I have it, and how I can be ready to push that to production. And this is this idea of automate everything all the time. For example, Facebook, as far as I know, they have the concept of deployment rings. Then when someone commits some code, first, before being pushed to the central repository, it needs to be reviewed by a pair. It needs to pass all the unit tests, all the tests, and blah, 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 blah. Okay. After that, when it's on the central repository, it will be sent to production on a first ring. And this first ring, only concerns the employees of Facebook. So they are using a version of Facebook that is ahead from yours. If they have no problem, short time after, this version will go automatically to a second ring. And this second ring is a subset of users in the world. I don't know, maybe in States. I don't know. And then a third ring with more users and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And if there is no problem, all the updates will propagate like this in the different rings inside the whole infrastructure of Facebook. Of course, to do this, to be that efficient, you need to have tools and practice very well in place and very well installed in the culture. Continuous integration, of course, TDD, of course, code reviews, continuous code auditing with tools like Sonar, functional test automation, strong non-functional tests. I will talk about a very good one by Facebook later on about performance, availability. You need to make sure that the code you are pushing to production is respecting the expected performance or the expected rules about availability. Of course, automated packaging and deployment. And this idea of zero downtime deployment. When they push in production 10 times a day, they are not shutting down the website. Please wait while we are being updating the server. No, it's zero downtime. The servers are always there continuously. And they find ways to, we could talk hours about this. They find a way to keep the service up and running while they are being updated server after server after server, or cluster after cluster after cluster. But maybe you would say to me, okay, this is very nice, but if I push code every day, I never seen any feature of any of normal importance that I can code in one day. How I can push in production features that are not finished, or I don't have time to develop features. And this is a key idea that they are using. It's the feature flipping. There exist various names: feature flipping, feature toggles, feature switch. It's just like this. If feature is enabled with the name of a feature, I do something new. Else, I do the same as before. And with this, and you just need to change the configuration to enable or disable the feature. Or you can enable it on quality assurance systems or test systems, and not having it enabled on production. You can choose where it is enabled. And this is fantastic, because with this, pushing code to production is not equal to pushing a feature to production. You can decorrelate the readiness of the feature and the code that you're pushing to production. So you can push code every day, even if the feature is not finished. You can enable or disable a feature in seconds. Okay, I enable, it's not working, I disable in seconds right now, so I don't need to do rollbacks. Of course, if I did my job very well with this kind of test. And I can even do what we call graceful degradation. Imagine I have a very high peak of usage of users coming to my website, and all the machines are going down because of the load. I can just switch off the features that are not so mandatory for my business, and maybe I can save some 10% of load that will make my server survive. And this is this idea of graceful degradation. You can also use the same idea for a typical user, for one user, not for all of them, but for one user. This is A/B testing. You can enable a feature, a new feature, a new landing page, a new thing to this user because he's being flagged in the configuration system to have this new feature for the test. But this is not magic. Doing this is very powerful, but it has a huge cost. The first cost is that your code doesn't just look like with a bunch of if-then-else, if-then-else, if-then-else all the time. Second thing is that you need to test all the options in your unit test. Third option is when a feature is up and running in production since a long time, you need to clean up all these if-then-else that are here for months in your code. So this has a cost. This has a cost. You need to put processes to manage that in your developer team, but that's what they are doing. Maybe when some of you will say, yes, okay, if then else in the code, I can do it. I do it every day. Enabling or disabling a feature on production, okay, I'm doing it every day, but still I have a problem because I have databases, and the databases, my databases are very huge, like terabytes, and when I have a change of data model, I need to migrate the data, and it's not a zero downtime deployment. I have to stop everything, migrate the data, it takes hours, and then I have to run the things up again. Yes, it's true. But there exist some strategies. I won't go very deep in this explanation because, again, we can talk, we can do lots of diagrams on the whiteboard to discuss this option, but more or less, the idea when you change a model, when it is a relational model like this, it's easier with a NoSQL system, but with a relational system, it's possible. The idea is passing into a hybrid in-between version that support the old structure of data and the new structure of data, and having a step in your evolution of software that support this hybrid phase. You put that into production, and during that time, so the system is running and you can take the time to migrate the data. It can take hours, but the system is working and working with a hybrid version of your data. So it's okay. I will not go very deep in this. It's long. If you want, we can discuss of this. It's very interesting. It's working. We develop software at Okto, especially one software called Appaloosa. We develop like this, and it's okay. It's painful, but it works. There is another thing. I find this very interesting. It's Facebook did this. Is when you are Facebook with billions of declared users and millions of simultaneous users in your system, you have data centers everywhere in the world, how you do a load testing for a new feature? You just go to your CEO. Good morning, I want a new data center to do a load testing. No, it's not working. And they invented this. It's about the when they created the chat, I think it was 3 or 4 years ago, created the chat application in Facebook. We chose to simulate the impact of many real users eating many machines by means of a dark launch period in which Facebook pages would make connection to the chat servers, query for presence information, and simulate message sends without single UI element drawn on the web page. Meaning that you went on your Facebook at that time and someone of the user in the world had a JavaScript working in the background just sending message to the infrastructure, and during that time they just took measure about how the infrastructure work, how the infrastructure scaled before opening this service to everyone. Yes, it's a load test on production platform. This is brilliant. Of course, you need to be very structured in your process, but they managed to do it. And of course, so I talked about DevOps, infrastructure as code, continuous delivery with this strategy to put new code into production and see what happens, and collaboration. Dev and ops need to collaborate a lot. They must make them understand each other and break the wall between them. It's a culture of collaboration. Make them love each other. They use this idea of you build it, run it. You are the developer of a feature. You are a developer of a feature. You will be the man who will be woken up at night to when there is a problem. It's like this in Facebook, like this in Amazon, like this in many web giants. You build some software, you will run this software. How they do this? Especially they open the tools to the devs. This is a dashboard of the metrics of a production system. I think it's Etsy, but I'm not sure about this. I think it's Etsy. And okay, it's not for ops, it's for devs. And the devs live with that to learn how their software is working into production and to operate it. Let's move on to the last part, better. This is one of the things I prefer in this presentation, is the design for failure, and especially what Netflix did in this subject. So remember, we are using commodity hardware that fails all the time. Werner Vogels, the CTO of Amazon, says everything fails all the time. He repeats that over and over and over, everything fails all the time. So you need to build a software that will support failure. And what is the philosophy of Netflix? Their philosophy. So if you don't know, Netflix is 100% deployed on Amazon. They don't have any infrastructure at all. Everything is in Amazon Web Services. And their philosophy is to say the best way to avoid failure is to fail constantly. And they developed the Chaos Monkey. Chaos Monkey is a library, is a small agent that is deployed on all the machines of Amazon that introduce randomly some chaos, some entropy in the system. And randomly, every day, the Chaos Monkey kills a virtual machine on production. We, in our IT department, we are struggling to avoid the small itch on the small problems on virtual machine. They kill the virtual machine constantly, every day. In 1 year, they are able to do 65,000 of deaths of virtual machine like this. They do this constantly, all the time, all the time, all the time. And they measure, as they measure everything all the time, they measure that everything is fine, that the service is 100% okay without this virtual machine that just been killed by a Chaos Monkey. This is brilliant. I love this idea. They also have the Chaos Gorilla. So the gorilla is not killing one machine, it's killing a full availability zone in Amazon. It's like shutting down a full data center like this, just to test if the system is working well. This is what they do. And it saved them from problems. I don't know if you remember, I think it's 2 or 3 years ago, 2 years. Amazon had a big outage that impacted almost 100% of the customer, I think it's in Arizona, I don't remember well, but most of their customers were down due to Amazon, except Netflix, because Netflix is used to have some deaths of virtual machine in their system. This is crazy. The Netflix engineering blog is fantastic. Just go and see what they have, and they have presentation about this, and they have a description of this library that they developed, Netflix Hystrix. Hystrix is a latency and fault tolerance library designed to isolate points of access to remote systems, services, and third-party libraries, stop cascading failure, and enable resilience in complex distributed systems where failure is inevitable. Netflix architecture is a kind of service-oriented architecture with a lot of REST APIs talking to each other to build, so they have very fine-grained services that are combined into bigger services that are exposed to the web and to the and to partners and to their own interfaces. And so when you consume a service, when you consume a feature, it involves many calls into an arborist, a tree of calls in various APIs everywhere in the system. And they put in between two components calling each other, they put this Hystrix. I don't know if you see well here, you see some functional functional aspects like here is search autocomplete, get user info, get payment info, things like this. And all these systems. So Istrix is between two services calling each other, and see, and if one of these services is not responding, Istrix will prevent to have the calling service being having a timeout or having or dropping or being shut down because of this failure. And so they have some strategies. Okay, they have some default answer. They protect the latency from the timeouts. Many they can use cached version instead of what is in the data store. Okay, it's very complex, and they are able to monitor all these Istrix agents in the systems to see that everything is working fine. You don't, unfortunately, here for people here, you don't see. But here we have also some green circles showing also some traffic. It's a brilliant system, very, very interesting. And this leads to, this leads me to this idea of the cult of measurement. As we seen with Istrix, as we seen in the MVP concept with the A/B testing, with all of the with the white paper I quoted in the beginning, where they evaluated the commodity hardware, they measure everything all the time. There is a cult of measuring everything. I will quote this guy, so he's not a web giant, but he's a giant in computing science. Deming, he said this: "In God we trust, all others must bring data. This is the culture of the web giant." For example, Werner Vogels, the CTO of Amazon: "Everyone must be able to experiment, learn, and iterate. Position, obedience, and tradition should not hold no power. For innovation to flourish, measurement must rule." They measure this all the time. Of course, they measure usage they have of their service. They measure infrastructure, as we've seen, from the whole data center to the single hard disk drive power consumption, to say, okay, we have a deviation on this family of hard disk drive, we have a problem on 1,000 machine. All this kind of thing. Of course, they measure operational processes, as we could do in many companies. They also measure sales. At Google, they measure self-service restaurant queue lengths, just to adapt the snack. And so it's interesting because they say that if the queue is too long, the people will lose in productivity. But if the queue is too short, people won't have time to discuss before getting a snack, so it's not good for creativity and exchange in the company. So they adapt the snack to for this. This is crazy. They even get measurement in the management practice, and they publish the result in a white paper. If you read this paper, you will say, but what, they just reinvented hot water, like doing feedbacks to your employees good, or like this kind of thing. So you'd say, okay, it's just management, classical management. For a good manager already knows that. The difference is that they get measured. They have measured this, so it's not a gut feeling, it's not intuition, it's not empirical, it's measured and scientific. And they do this all the time, constantly. So this is the culture that good ideas come from the field, from real data, because managers always have or tend to have biases, and this is demonstrated when you are in a position of manager, you tend to have biases in the way you interpret information, and instead they provide data. Okay, in God we trust, all others must bring data. And ask they measure everything. They ask themselves what is the size of what is the best size for a team. So this is a study published on QSM, and they studied many projects with many team size, and they say, okay, the best size for productivity and lowest amount of variation of deviation is 5 to 7 people. And so now many of the web giants are sticking to this rule of having small teams. Amazon, they even call that the two pizzas team. Two pizzas, it's the team size that you can feed with two pizzas. Okay, big American pizza, but okay, it's 5 to 7 people because it's the best. So Amazon do this. Yahoo limits size of their teams between 5 and 10, at least the first year of development of a product. Viadeo, so the competitor of LinkedIn, they try to stick to team size of 5 to 6 people. Instagram, Dropbox, Evernote, so in the startup domain, they also try hard to keep small teams. And this is the more efficient team are the small team, because smaller teams, you have less you have less creativity. Bigger teams, you lose a lot of productivity by the communication between all the members of the team. So, okay, let's say you want to create small teams, but how you organize this? Traditionally, in IT companies, we use lots of IT companies have this kind of organization. If you look to the right, they have component-oriented team. Like, I have a team to manage the front end. I have a team dedicated to the back end. I have a team dedicated to the middleware. I have a team doing the frameworks for the next version, etc., etc. What happens when you use this kind of organization is when you have a backlog of feature on the left, you may have features like feature one that is for team front. It will be implemented by the front. Feature two is for the front as well. Feature four impacts everyone. So to manage the move to production of feature four, you need to coordinate all the teams together to be ready. And as you see, the team front is just overloaded with work. So the other, they don't have so much work in their backlog, and the team front is just overloaded. Everybody waits for everybody. This is a problem. And you also have feature, like feature five, you don't even know where, on which component you need to hit, because you didn't analyze it enough. So you don't even know before. There is another way to manage this, is what we call feature teams. So it's very close to the idea that are in the agile, in the agile culture, is to have cross-functional teams and to have in the same team a product owner, a UX designer, developers, tester, and even ops, because you build it, you run it, so you need an ops in the team. A small team, two pizzas, so 5 to 7 people. And they are feature-oriented, meaning that they are dedicated to put a feature in production. So they will take care of all the components at once. So you will mix developer from the front, developer from the back, developer from the middleware in the same team. And they are autonomous to pick a feature and push that to production. The web giants favor this kind of organization. If you look at the Amazon e-commerce website, the shopping cart, the search, the recommendation, the menu, all these elements are of different feature teams. So one single page is from different feature teams working in parallel, and they are not pushing the code and their version into production at the same time. They are completely autonomous to make their feature evolve. So the teams are autonomous to design, develop, test, and put in production their own backlog of features without being blocked by other teams. Spotify, they produced a very interesting book. It's not a book, it's a white paper, maybe 10 pages. Just have a look at it, Scaling Agile at Spotify. It's written by Henrik Nyberg, he's very famous in the Agile community. And they have precisely this kind of organization. So just look vertically, don't look at the rest, I will explain everything. Just look vertically you have squad. And each squad is leaded by a product owner. And each squad is an autonomous Scrum team and they are able to develop the features of their own backlog. And on Spotify application, you have a Scrum team, so a squad for the recommendation, a squad for the playlist, a squad for the player, and a squad for the mobile application. And they are organized like this. So they have the product owner and all the squads below. And what they say in this white paper is that, so a squad is similar to a Scrum team and is designed to feel like a mini startup. They sit together. They have all the skills and tools needed to design, develop, test, and release to production. And a tribe like this, a tribe is a collection of squads that work in related areas. You may say to me, okay, I have cross-functional teams, so if I go back to my example of just before, with a front, a back, or with Spotify, I have recommendation. The component in the Spotify is the player, the whole application is a component. And you may say, okay, but all the feature teams are working concurrently on the same components. So they may just screw up everything. They may just do things in concurrence. They may duplicate code, use concurrent libraries. I don't know, libraries that does not fit well together. They may lose the consistency of the whole components. This is crazy to have this. It may break into all directions. And this is true. That's why when you do this, in fact, I did a project with this kind of organization. You need, in French, it's contre-pouvoir. You need an opposite power. You need someone else who is in charge of the component and who is in charge of this precise technology. So if you have a component in Java, he will be in charge of make sure that all the feature teams respect the good practices in Java or the good practices for this technology. And in Spotify, it's called chapters. So they have these horizontal chapters that are the opposite power, that balancing the power of the PO, the product owner. So the product owner wants new features. And the chapter guys say, no, we need also to manage the refactoring, to manage the, merge of several libraries or things like this. And they manage this. So the chapter, as they say in the paper, the chapter is a small family of people having similar skills, for example, all the Java developers, and working within the same general competency area or the same component. I will pass on the guild. Guild is a kind of a very organic, autonomous things just to share. It's like this would be a guild would organize an hackathon inside Spotify, for example. Okay, we gather many people, we do an hackathon, and we work together, and that's it. It's, maybe it's not related to the application, it's just to get people attracted around some point of interest.
Share knowledge,
exactly. And they also, they recognize the value of good developers, of senior developers. In many companies, you start as a junior developer, and very fast, people, managers, will propose you to become a project manager or something like this. And so you leave the developer path and you become a project manager or something like this. Here, not at all. They recognize the value of having very good developers, talented developers, or developers that are 40 years old because and they are very experienced, and they will bring a lot to the company. They value this because they understand that if an idea worth one, a well-executed idea worth 100, 1,000, 10 million dollars, we don't know, but if it's well-executed, with a good quality, with a great great things between developer, you can have a very great service like Twitter of this kind of companies. And so they make what is necessary to attract and hire the best developers. So there is this website, Glassdoor, and they collect information about how the developers are paid. And for example, in at Facebook, a software engineering intern is paid $70,000 a year. A senior software engineer is $132,000 a year because they value people. They value developers that have the skills, the knowledge to do great things. The opposite idea is that if you pay peanuts, you get monkeys. So you need to pay people very well and you will have the best. They are also known to have very tough technical interviews to get only the best developers. In the past, Google, they had 20 interviews to hire someone, 20 interviews. But as they measure everything, they detected that 4 interviews was enough to filter out the bad and keep the good. So now it's 4 interviews. But they started with 20 interviews and they with difficult technical tests in entrance. And also, of course, they develop the talents with a lot of trainings. This culture of code review and pair programming to make people grow, mentoring. This idea also of the, maybe you have already heard about that, the 20% of time at Google or at another company, the slack time is dedicated to R&D or to personal project. You do whatever you want. Hackathons, of course, and strong open source involvement because they know that open source involvement make people grow and attract the good people. Of course, maybe you already know that, they have incredible buildings, incredible offices, and they invest a lot of money to have a very comfortable offices to have the best for their people. That's it for this presentation. As a conclusion, I would like to quote French philosopher. He's called Michel Serres, and he went to our conference in France, the UZ. And Michel Serres said that in history there were three big revolutions, and all these revolutions are related to a change in the way we communicate together. The first revolution is the invention of writing. So before writing is prehistory, after writing is history, with the apparition of the first cities, the beginning of economy, and the very first governments. The second revolution is the invention of printing that led to the end of feudality, a revolution in the religious power and organization of the religious power, explosions of arts in Europe with the Renaissance. And what he says is that today, with the internet, we are living the third big revolution. Everything is being reinvented, social communication, social links, economy, culture, all needs to be reinvented again. Just think about the problems of intellectual property, laws, there is no law on the internet, fiscality, privacy. So he is convinced, I believe him, he is convinced that we are living a revolution right now, that everything will change, and the fact is that the web giants are ahead of this. They are showing not the path to follow, but they are showing things to us for good or for bad, and it's interesting to look at them and get inspired on the way they live ahead of us in this revolution. I think this is fascinating because software is eating the world. Thank you. This is the end of this talk. If you have any question or anything, you can ask me. To get these slides, to get the book in French for free to download, to be notified when the book is available in English, just send me a mail. You have my address. If you have question, just send me a mail. If you want me to repeat this talk to your manager or your CIO, please send me a mail. It will be a pleasure for me to repeat this to CIOs, to explain them what the web giants are doing. Okay, thank you.